Shuklam Bharadharam Vishnum Shashivarnam Chaturbhujam Prasannavadanam Dhyayet Sarva Vigno Pashantaye Ramaya Ramabhadraya Ramachandraya Vedhase Raghunathaya Nathaya Sitaya Pataye Namaha Om. Dear friends, we are seeing the Valmiki Ramayana. We are in this Yuddha Kanda. We just entered Yuddha Kanda and we are in the fourth Sarga where army is moving forward. Because we know that Rama, Sugriva and all these people, they were there in Kishkindha. From Kishkindha, all the people have now started. They have started moving towards the seashore. That is the southern shore of now what is called India now. So, at that time, of course, Bharatavarsha. So, they were moving towards the south. So, that is what we have been seeing. And the whole army was actually moving like an ocean. And the description was there. And Lakshmana was also telling about some very good omens. Lakshmana was talking about the position of the stars. Various stars are in very good condition. And our own family stars, because his Surya Vamsha, from this Surya Vamsha, their forefathers, etc., some Trishanku star, very, very shining, very bright. And the stars of the Rakshasas are very dull. So Lakshmana seems to be somebody. Why not only Lakshmana, but everybody in those days, they all had some knowledge of the stars. In fact, even a couple of maybe generations ago, the people, they were so well conversant with the natural things. They were conversant with how the, the movements of the sun, the movements of the moon. We now know more science. We know many facts scientifically. But then, natural observation was more in the case of old people. So, at that time, there was a lot of knowledge about the position of the stars, etc. And in this particular position, okay, it is good. In some other position, it is bad, etc., etc. And there are some stars which are supposed to denote the Rakshasas. And all those stars are very, very dull. So, that's what this Lakshmana was saying. Nairutam Nairutanam cha Nakshatram Ati Pidyate. It is under harassment. That particular nakshatra is very, very dull, and it is looking as though it is pidyate, that is, it is being harassed. Then our army formations are moving very, very brightly, and harsham viryam balodreka darshayanta parasparam. And all these young vanara army, they were all very jubilant, young, jubilant. Harsham is happiness, viryam, that valor, balodreka. Balodreka means each person is feeling stronger than anybody else. Each man feeling that he is the strongest man. Balodreka. Darshayantah parasparam. They are just trying to show off their strength. And that is the exuberance. We can say that is that exuberance. Yavanotsekajat darpat. Yavanotseka. That is the exuberance of the youth. Because the youthful, usually the youthful people, they are so exuberant. So all that exuberance was seen there. And they all traveled. Saasmayati divaratram mahati harivahini. That great harivahini. Harivahini is that army of the monkeys. They yati divaratram. That is both day and night they traveled. How many days? We are not sure. Let us see. They moved day and night and then they just moved up. And they are almost reaching that Sahyadri. Sahyadri is what we now call the western ghats of India, and that is called the Sahyadri. And they are going through various forests full of fruits, and then all that various madhavyo gandhapurnascha, and all types of fruit giving trees, and full of fruits. So they are moving in that area, and there are some fresh water lakes also. Varijaihi vividhaih pushpaihi ramyastatra jalashayah. There were some very, very pretty good water lakes were there. And they all had a lot of food on the en route, because earlier Rama had told, Neela, he is the army chief. He told, you have to check out such a way where the army will get food. Because I told you, the army, usually it is said to be, army is said to march on its belly. So that is, unless the food rations, food is perfectly there, the food supply is perfectly there, the army will not go. Army cannot go, they feel demoralized, they feel dispirited. So they usually have the food very much in time. So like that, these people also, they had nice food, they had some fresh water. And they also then snatva pitvodakan pitvodakanyatra. They also they just drank, not only drank but also they had their bath in their rivers, etc. And en route babanjuhu vanarastatra padapanam madotkata. And en route they also saw huge honeycombs in the jungle. Usually in the jungle areas we can see huge honeycombs, and those huge honeycombs with a lot of honey in it. So these people, they broke the honeycombs and ate all the honey. And then finally they are reaching that Mahendragiri. Tata shikara maruhya ramo dasharathatmaja. Here I have skipped so many verses, because if somebody is following the book, you may not be able to locate this verse, because I have skipped a lot of description about various trees and fruits and how these people, they were crossing rivers, etc. And when they were crossing rivers, actually, because it was such a huge army crossing the river, and when they are going through the river and the water was stopped, and then water, it was flowing back in the opposite direction. So that means they were in such large numbers and also large size also. They were also huge in size and so many people crossing. So all that description I have skipped. And finally, these people, they have reached that Mahendragiri. We know that Mahendragiri is the same place from where Hanuman took a leap. From this Mahendragiri itself, Hanuman took a leap and then jumped to that place. Then tata shikara maruhya ramo dasharathatmaja. Then Rama got onto that hill. We don't know whether it is a mountain or hill. Shikara maruhya ramo dasharathatmaja. He got onto that hill. And then he saw that ocean, huge ocean, which is Kurma Meena Samakirnam Apashyat Salilakulam. Kurma Meena, and he saw that huge ocean with all these aquatic animals and all that, and saw that mighty ocean. Then again, I'm skipping lot many shlokas in this fourth chapter, because the fourth sarga. So again, he said, okay, let the army camp here, because the huge army is following. The army has to be camped somewhere. Tadihaiva niveshostu mantra prasuyatamiha. Now the greatest task is how to cross the ocean. So they have to sit and plan out. Okay, let the army camp here. Let us stop here and then discuss the plans as to how we can cross over the ocean. Then swam swam senam samusrujya, and also he issued orders. Nobody should leave the army. Nobody should leave his assigned position, because when the army camps. Okay, army is in various contingents. Okay, this is number one contingent, number two contingent, number three contingent, etc. Like we see in our drill classes. So first team, second team, third team, like that. So that team, each team is kept in a particular place. There is a team commander. The team commander will be monitoring the movements of all the people. So he should see that nobody goes out from whatever area is earmarked to them. So such orders, all these orders, of course, Valmiki seems to be so perfect in all these army formations, battlecraft, etc. We can see this in sage Vyasa also. In Mahabharata, if we see, there are more descriptions about how the battle was, how the army was poised, how the army was stationed. What is some sort of eagle formation one day and a lotus formation on another day. That famous lotus formation, we can recall, that Padma view as it is called. That lotus formation, which was so impregnable, and nobody can enter except Abhimanyu. So like that, Valmiki also, all these great poets, they had a knowledge of a lot of human knowledge available at that time had to be known by the poet. Now of course, even the poetry is so diversified. Somebody writes love poetry, somebody writes some other poetry, somebody writes revolutionary poetry, etc., etc. And somebody totally, absolutely, bhavakavitvam, as we say, just emotional. And they may or may not be knowing. But here, the great poets who wrote the epics, particularly the epics, they are the people who have to be knowledgeable about the entire human knowledge which is available at that particular time. For example, in Valmiki, we find references to astronomy. We find references to various other shastras. We find a lot of dharma shastra, a lot of discussion on dharma, a lot of discussion on various other things which are mentioned in the Vedic Vedas. So all this, the entire message of the Vedas, what all is mentioned in the Vedas, that also has to be known. And so then this writer is supposed to be a person who is, say, very well versed in all the shastras of that time. So that is what we see here. Now he is talking about how this army has to be deployed, army has to be stationed, and no one should leave the team, and there can be any danger. any hidden danger here. Shuraha, gyayam channam bhayam, bhayam chana, channam bhayam, channa, channa means something, some sort of hidden danger, something which we do not know. Maybe the enemy, what are the places where the enemy can hide? These are the people, they are supposed to keep a watch. Then Ramasya vachanam shrutva, Sugriva saha lakshmanaha, then receiving the orders from Rama, then Sugriva and all other people, they just monitored how the army was deployed. And some smaller, all these captains and people like that, they just went round and then saw that all the people are in their places. Then again there is a description of the sea. Then again, hasantamiva fenaughaihi nrutyantamiva churmibhi, and they saw that ocean. And that ocean, it was looking as though, sometimes it was hasantamiva, with all that foam and whatnot. When that foam was seen, lot of foam was seen, it was looking as though the ocean was smiling. It was hasanti. Hasanti means laughing or smiling. Then sometimes nrutyantamiva chormibhi, when the huge waves they came, it looked as though it was dancing. So it all depends on the poet's imagination. Valmiki is not only an epic writer but also a kavya writer. We know the difference between an epic and a kavyam. Epic is a much, much larger, it has got a much, much larger canvas. A poet, of course, it has a smaller canvas. There is more of beauty in that. So Valmiki is combining beauty and also the epic, the art of epic. So here we see the description of the ocean. So hasantamiva phenaughaihi nrutyantamiva chormibhi. Nrutyam is the dance. Dance with this mighty waves and all that. And again the sea. Now there is a description of the sea. There is a nice shloka which says, sagaram cha ambaraprakhyam ambaram sagaropamam. This ocean was looking like the sky, because when you just go for the first time, when you see the ocean, you feel totally impressed by that, so totally impressed by the vastness of that ocean. And just see anywhere around and then you just don't find any shore, and then you just only see that huge arch. Then sagaram cha ambaraprakhyam, the ambara is sky, sagaram is ocean. This ocean is looking like the sky and the sky is looking like the ocean. Ambaram sagarupam, sagaram cha ambaram cheti nirvishesham adrushyata. And there was no difference, one could not make out a difference where the army, where the ocean is ending or where the sky is ending. It looked so endless, basically to describe the vastness, endless, that is so endless, it looked so endless. Then sampruktam nabhasa ambha, that is the waters of the ocean, the sampruktam means the waters of the ocean, it looked as though it blended with the ocean, it blended with the sky, and sky looked as though it blended with the ocean waters. Then samutpetu samutpatita meghasya, okay, the clouds in the sky, one could see the clouds, and on in the ocean the huge waves in the ocean, they looked like the huge clouds in the sky. So the clouds in the sky and waves in the ocean, they just looked alike. Samutpatitam ekasya vichi mala kulasya cha. Vichi mala, vichi means a huge wave. So like that there is a description of all that. Then tato, and all these vanaras, it looks as though they also saw the ocean for the first time. Tato vismayam apanna, vismayam, vismayam means they were so surprised, they were so surprised to see that ocean, that mightiness of the ocean. Tato vismayamapanna harayu dadrushusthitaha bhranta urmi jala sannadam. All these waves, they were just rolling, they were just waters rising up and rolling back, like we see in that surf riding. We can see all that waves, how the waves they just rise up and again roll. It looks as though a sort of curve they form. So that is bhranta urmi jala sannadam pralolamiva sagaram. So that is how this description of the ocean and then the movement of all this army and the stationing of the army at the sea shore, all that we see in this sarga. Then the next sarga, that is a moonlit night, that is a full moon, there is a full moon, and now Rama is remembering Sita. Army is camping, Rama and Lakshmana are alone, and now Rama is expressing his feelings to Lakshmana. Of course, Rama has to share his feelings with Lakshmana only, there is no one else. He can't share with Sugriva, he can't share with anybody else. So Lakshmana is like a sort of friend, philosopher, and if not guide, a sort of totally trusted man. So Rama he expresses all his emotions. We have seen it in Aranyakanda, we have seen it in Kishkindha Kanda. Now again we see Satu Nilena Vidhivat Swaraksha Susamahita. That particular army, it was under the leadership of that Neela. Neela, we know, is the commander, and that army was very well stationed there. Of course, I am skipping some verses here. And now, Shokasya Kilakaliena Gachata. And then Rama is now giving vent to his ideas. So he is saying, people say that Shokasya Kilakaliena Gachata Hyapagachati. People say that sorrow, slow, but as the time goes, usually people say, as the time goes, we forget our sorrows. That is what people say. But that is not coming true in my case. The more it is prolonged, the more I am feeling that sorrow. Then, there is a wonderful shloka here. That is shloka 6. This shloka is describing Vahi Vata Yatah Kanta. And of course, people who know music. In fact, I have heard this some of these shlokas sung by one good singer, one gentleman who was there in one district named Kadapa. There was one poet. He was also a poet. He used to sing also. And he used to sing some of these love poems of Rama. Vahi vata yatah kanta tam sprushtva mamapi sprusha. Now you imagine, there is Rama is camping on this shore of the ocean, and Sita is there in Lanka on the other shore of the ocean. There is a seashore, and not exactly on the shore. It may not be right on the shore, maybe slightly away inside. We need not go into technical details whether she is right now on the shore or what. So now he is requesting the breeze. Because the breeze is coming from south to north. The breeze or the wind is coming from south to north. And Rama is in the north and Sita is in the south. So he is requesting that wind, oh wind, go and touch Sita and then come and touch me. What a wonderful, go touch Sita and then touch me. So that in you, I am embracing Sita. That is the meaning. Vahi vata yatah kanta, you go and touch that lady. That yatah kanta, where that kanta is, that Sita is there, and tam sprushtva mamapi sprusha, then you touch her and then touch me. Then tvayi me gatra sanyoga, in you I am embracing Sita, gatra sanyoga, and chandre drushti samagama. Okay, you had an embrace, then what about looking at her? Then, okay, I am seeing Sita in that moon, because right now I am looking at the moon. And probably Sita also is looking at the moon. And I am seeing Sita's eyes in the moon. So that is a wonderful way that the poet describes. In fact, this sort of imagery we find in various literatures, of course. In English literature, particularly in the 18th century, there was one group of poets called the metaphysical poets. Some John Donne, Andrew Marvell and people like that. They took such metaphors. They took such metaphors, and it was actually a rage when these people, they wrote some poems like this. In fact, there was such a rage about all the rage means not anger. There were raving reviews, as we say. There was so much of craze, let us say, not rage, craze. There was so much of craze for that particular poetry and metaphysical, that is called metaphysical poetry. Metaphysical doesn't mean anything philosophical. That is basically bringing out various disparate elements into one poem. You see, wind is blowing, and in that wind, this man wants to have the embrace of Sita. Of course, we should not ask about the logicality of all these things, because in a poem, that too in a love poem, a lover is somebody who doesn't know any rules. And similarly, a poet also doesn't know any rules. In fact, regarding poetry, it is said, a poet is somebody who doesn't follow the laws of nature. He doesn't follow the rules of nature when he is giving such descriptions. You know, on all other matters, okay, when he is writing about dharma, he very much follows the rule book. When he is writing about something else, he follows the rule book. But when he is talking about, when he is describing something, when he is talking about love or something like that, then there is no rule. There is a book called Kavya Prakasha. That book says, Niyati Kruta Niyama Rahitam. Niyati Kruta Niyama Rahitam means poetry is something where the natural laws do not apply to that. all these laws of nature, they just do not apply. So when the king, when the lover is asking, okay, you just touch her and touch me, I am going to have embrace in you. Yes, you have to believe in it. He is feeling that embrace, and so long as Rama is feeling the embrace, you and I need not have any problem. So Rama is enjoying that embrace, and Rama is also looking at the moon, and having, and he is in that moon, he is also looking at Sita. Chandre drushti samagamaha tanme dahati gatrani. There are some more shlokas like that. Tanme dahati gatrani vitam visham pitam ivashaye. Oh, I am feeling as though my entire body is burning, as though I have taken pitam visham. Visha is the poison. As though I have taken poison, my entire body is burning. And now, again, similar imagination. Both of us, we live on the same ground. I am on the same ground. I am also on the ground, and Sita also is on the ground. That is actually keeping me alive. Otherwise, I would not have lived. It would have been very difficult to live. Yadaham sacha vamauruhu ekam dharani mashritav. Ekam dharani mashritav means we are on the same earth. So that is what is keeping me alive. So like that, there is some description about when will I see Sita? Oh, when will I look into her face? Oh, when will I embrace her? So all such shlokas. And one or two shlokas, there is some excess also. And I really wonder whether really Valmiki has written it, or somebody else with in over enthusiasm he has put more Shrungara into that. Because in this particular passage, people may object to some little bit of Shrungara in some shlokas. Because Rama, is it proper for Rama to describe about Sita's body and bodily parts in front of Lakshmana? So such shlokas are there. I am skipping all those shlokas. If you are interested, you can see this fifth sarga. So I am skipping because I feel that some over enthusiastic poet, because in our country, the epic time, the poets were very, very serious. And sometime in the Middle Ages, because there was so much of prosperity in India, and India was known, fabled for its prosperity. That is the reason why all the invaders came to India. So when such was the condition, then what were the poets doing? Poets were only describing all women. They were describing all the bodily parts of women. So definitely Valmiki would not have done that. Somebody could have introduced some such shlokas. Anyway, so now we see Rama describing Sita also. And finally, Lakshmana consoles. We have seen even earlier that whenever Rama is in some sort of distressed condition or a disappointed mood, then it is Lakshmana who actually cheers him up. So now he is also cheering him up. Ashvasito Lakshmanena Ramas Sandhyam Upasat. Lakshmana consoled him, and then he said, he gave all courage, no, you are surely going to see Sita, etc., some assurance. Then Ramaha Sandhyam Upasata. And Valmiki, again, we see that we have seen this is the nightfall. Nightfall, it has not become fully dark, not dark, it is actually a moonlit night. It has not yet become full night. It is the Sandhya time. So he also performed this Sandhya. This Sandhya Vandana is something which Rama doesn't forget, and Valmiki also doesn't forget. Smaran Kamalapatrakshim Sitam Shokakuli Kutaha. And even at that time, he was only remembering Sita. Okay, then we come to the next sarga. This next sarga, that is sixth sarga, we now move to Ravana. We are now seeing Ravana. We have seen, when did we see Ravana last? We saw in that Sundarakanda, where Hanuman had an interaction with him, and Ravana said, okay, set fire to his tail, because Vibhishana said, a duta means an ambassador, or whoever, envoy, let us say, an envoy should not be killed. Even if he has done some excesses, there are some other punishments which are prescribed for an envoy, so an envoy should not be killed. So Ravana said, okay, in that case, set fire to his tail, because the vanaras, all the monkeys, they love their tails. And this man will go tailless, and all his friends and girlfriends, and not girlfriends, of course, we should say his wife, let us say, and all his relatives and wife, etc., they will all laugh at him. So that is what Ravana thought. But unfortunately for Ravana, something else had happened. Nothing happened to the tail of Hanuman, only this Lanka city got burnt. So now Ravana is rather ashamed of it. We see Ravana sitting on his throne with a sense of shame and head slightly down. He says, Abravid Rakshasan Sarvan. Sarvan, Hriya Kinchid Avang Mukhaha. Hriya, Hri means some sense of shame. Hri. Hriya Kinchid Avang Mukhaha. Avang Mukhaha means slightly bent down. He is not in his usual mood, but he is slightly bent down and he is feeling rather ashamed. And he is telling his ministers and he is in his court. In that court, the royal court, he is now saying, Darshita cha pravishta cha lanka dushprasaha puri. Darshita means, after all, an ordinary monkey, dushpra, tena vanaramatrena. Vanaramatrena means, after all, a monkey. Vanaramatra, manushyamatra we say. Manushyamatra means, after all, a man. Vanaramatrena, after all, by a monkey. City has been darshita. Darshita means it has been invaded. It has been ransacked. And pravishtasha, that vanara entered, and not only that, Lanka dushprasaha puri, and drushta sita cha janaki, and Sita also has been seen by him, and now prasado dharshitas chaitya, and there was one chaitya prasada. We saw that there was one very beautiful building. It was supposed to be a jewel. It was almost like a jewel for Lanka. That jewel of Lanka, that huge mighty building, that was also destroyed. We saw that Ashokavana, in that Ashokavana, after seeing Sita, then initially some gods, they came, the Kinkaras. And Hanuman bet up all those Kinkaras. And thereafter, he just saw a beautiful building in that Ashokavana. And that beautiful, huge building, beautiful building, he just destroyed that thing. That is, he is saying that Chaitya Prasada. So Hanum, this Ravana is saying the jewel of Lanka has been shattered. Then now then Kim Karishyami Bhadram Vaha. Then what shall we do? Kim Karishyamaha. Kim Karishyami Bhadram Vaha. Kim Vo Yuktam Anantaram. And you all tell then in fact success depends on this basic strategy. Success depends on strategy. Now Ravana is telling certain things which will make it appear that, oh, Ravana is so democratic in his approach. So, any type of leader, even if he is very, very tyrannical, he will start on a very, very democratic note. He will make it appear as though he is so democratic. So, that is what Ravana is doing now. Mantramulam cha vijayam pravadanti manasvinaha. Mantramulam cha vijayam. Vijayam means success. Success is based on mantra. Mantra doesn't mean Gayatri mantra, this mantra, so Hanuman mantra, etc. Mantra, I told you, mantra means that is a strategy. The same word in different sciences or in different fields, it gives different meanings. Particularly, we see the literature. For example, in mantra, when you use that word in maybe Vedic literature, it refers to a particular mantra. Mantra drashta, one particular rishi has given this mantra, etc. So mantra, when you come to politics, when you come to Kautilya, mantra means strategy. You use the same word in some other in some other field, it may give some other meaning. Maybe in something like Vaidya, that is Sushruta's Vaidya Shastra, that is the field of medicine, it may give a totally different meaning. So like that. So mantra means strategy. And for success basically depends on our strategy. And tasmad vai roshaye mantram ramam prati mahabala. You are all very intelligent people, manasvinaha. Then I want to discuss strategy with you. And now he says, he is telling about three types of bosses. One boss who discusses with all the people and then takes a decision. He is saying vividhah purusha loke uttama adhama madhyamaha. He is actually classifying those people into three categories. Uttama, Adhama and Madhyama. Uttama means the highest, topmost. Then some middle level and something which is not undesirable, something failure cases. That is Adhama. Adhama is the lowest type. So now, who are the wisest, who are the topmost people? They are the people who consult all the wise ministers. Mantribhihi, yukta sanyuktaha, samarthaihi mantra nirnaye. And the person who consults or discusses with all these mantri, with all the mantris, and samarthaihi, and capable also, and those mantris also should be very capable people. So a person who takes, who discusses with all the people and develops a strategy, he is a good leader, he is the topmost leader. Then again, One who decides alone, he is the middle level leader. One who decides alone, he doesn't discuss with the people, but at the same time, he takes some decision.
Eko artham vimrushed, eko dharme prakurte manaha. Then ekah karyani kurute tamahur madhyamam naram. Tamahum tamahu madhyamam naram.
So madhyama is a middle level person. What is he? He doesn't discuss with other people, but he alone takes some decisions. After all, he takes some good decisions. Okay, he is the middle level person. So we'll continue tomorrow. He is talking about the third type of person who doesn't even think, who takes some quixotic decisions. So we'll see tomorrow. Harihi Om Tat Sat.